walk around, don't disregard it. Strip you off the ground, show you what heart is. Standing strong and proud, now I'm not kids. Let's get it started, it's the hardest. Talk around, don't disregard it. Sweep you off the ground, show you what heart is. Standing strong and proud, nothing can knock this. Let's get it started.
Yeah, get your boots ready. We're about to go on a trip where we wrestle, nobody settling, no calling it quits. You're here for the grit, betcha this stuff is amazing. You're stumbling, welcome to the bump in the apron. Step into it, the hardest part of the ring. Here to bring fun, yeah, in this art he is king. It's the best thing, making sure you don't tap out. Don't go soft with the hardest podcast out. And it's not just another one, it's clear. Off the rest, in this content, none contest. Take the nonsense off the steps. You know it's nothing but pure gems when it's coming off the chest. Get it? Now it's time to sit and relax. Get your mind blown away, ain't no skipping a track. Have you paying more attention, no listening gap. Get everything I ever wanted, no giving it back. Yeah.
Do you guys have to be everywhere? Every time this has to happen, like, oh. I thought this was my sanctuary where I could have, you know, none of you guys, because you're on every other TV show out there. Right, I guess that's what we're talking about today, huh? Yeah. I was planning on talking about XPW Halloween Hell, but I guess we'll talk about Judgment Day. What? 2003. Okay. Oh, okay, Dom. All right. Yeah, I mean, a time when Judgment Day wasn't Rhea, Dom, Finn, and Damien. Judgment Day was, in 2003, Judgment Day was Zach Gowen, Mr. America, Kevin Nash, and Sable's tits. I don't know. Judgment Day 2003. That's what we're talking about today. What a event. Presented by World Wrestling Entertainment. So one of my favorite things about this podcast is like walking through these eras of wrestling and living through transition periods. Because, you know, we've been in the Ruthless Aggression era for a while in this timeline, but it's particularly clear with this fucking card. I mean, look, we got some good. We got Brock Lesnar and Big Show in a stretcher match in the main event, which is great. You know, following up on the Big Show swinging Rey Mysterio like a baseball bat on the ring post. So there's some good stuff here. You got some fun tomfoolery with Stone Cold Steve Austin and Eric Bischoff. We get into the whole, you know, moving into an era without Stone Cold wrestling. We also, I mean, The Rock's gone. Kurt Angle's injured at this point, so we got a lot of new characters debuting, at least making their pay-per-view debuts on this show, like La Resistance. We got Spanky. I mean, the FBI's here. We got Roddy Piper's wrestling in them. We got Piper versus Hogan just in the middle of this pay-per-view. But we also got like an awesome ladder match between Team Angle and Eddie Guerrero and Tajiri. We also got the Intercontinental Championship coming back, being decided in a battle royal. So there's some good stuff on this show. It's just, it's wacky from start to finish, and I can't wait to get into it with my guest, Kenny, from... We don't have a podcast anymore. I mean, the podcast still exists. You can go check out A Kenny for Your Thoughts podcast, wherever you listen to podcasts, and YouTube. I mean, he hasn't come out with an episode in about 2 years now, but I think they're fairly evergreen, so go check him out. You probably know him from Twitter or X, whatever. So I guess he's just an X-Man? X-Man. I don't know, we'll workshop it. But he's a good follow on social media. Go check out Kenny wherever you social media. All that in the description below @_KennyThoughts on X. He's a good boy, a sweet gentleman, and perfectly symmetrical nipples. So for all those reasons, go follow him. Follow me as well. My nipples aren't as symmetrical, but @ApronBump on all of the social medias. you're watching on YouTube, give it a like, give me a subscribe, leave a comment. Who is your favorite member of Judgment Day? Listen to wherever you listen to podcasts, rate, review, all that shit. Hey, if you like this timeline of wrestling, you like the Ruthless Aggression era, one of the best eras of wrestling, in my opinion, but also gives you some of the worst stuff. but it's all very entertaining to talk about. Go to apronbump.com and you can go to the episodes tab at the top and you can filter down to whatever era or promotion you like. You would like to hear me recap, but I do it all across four different decades, companies big and small all over the world. But you can filter down to Ruthless Aggression era if you would like to, and that'll bring you to chronologically all of the pay-per-views from this era that I've covered so far, starting from the very beginning, mid-2002 up until now, about mid-2003, Judgment Day 03. So, binge away, have yourself a good old time, and hey, have yourself a good old time checking out this episode, WWE Judgment Day 2003, with myself and Kenny, also known as a Kenny for your thoughts, from Twitter X and stuff. I think he's also on Tout as well. I think he's the only guy there. Sometimes I wonder if I like actually started an OnlyFans, like if it would gain traction, you know?
Well, I don't know if you've seen like my post recently, but I've been joking about it and legitimately getting DMs of like, what's the link? And I'm like, and look, I'll just say it like this, men and women. So I'm like, you know, obviously some are kidding, but some are not. And I'm like, there's money to be had.
I mean, if the potential, like my wife was trying to sell some shoes on Facebook Marketplace and some guy asked to buy her socks for $100 a pair. And she said, no, like I'll deliver the socks if you need me to,
right, I will hand deliver them. We will show up and I will take them off of your feet and hand them to him.
I'll let him suck a toe if for $100 a pair. Good grief. But
thank God I'm not married to you.
You wouldn't sell your socks?
I never said that.
No.
I just said thank God I'm not married to you. Because I don't want you selling my socks.
Right. Well, it's purely physical. Right. There's an emotional level, I think, that's, you know.
Right. And it's kind of one of those things like I'm hoping that the more you resist, the more it persists. So
is that also a tag team? Resist and persist? That sounds like something.
No, but let's copyright it now.
That's gonna be our tag team,
right? Kind of. Let's do like Air Raid. You remember how they had like Air Styles and Air Paris? We should be like Resistance, like Kenny, and like Persistence, Kyle. Like,
no.
You don't like it. We'll I didn't remember asking, but I don't remember asking.
If you oh, so you're it. The leader of this faction.
No, I never said that.
You can't even get a purple bandana player. All of a sudden, you're the leader. Okay, I see. That's how.
There is no leader, actually, in the Judgment Day.
You don't think Mommy's the leader?
Now she is.
Yeah.
But I think that was just because they fell in line. But before, there was no leader.
Isn't it funny that Edge was a part of that at one time? It feels weird in hindsight.
Actually, it feels kind of messed up if you think about it. Because, like, it was his group.
Yes.
And it was just like, it was almost like supposed to be like, you know how Jericho had like the serious man character, and then like, you know, like those guys who get the later character and then they get another world title run with a different character. Mm-hmm. I felt like that was coming with Edge. And then for whatever reason, it was just like right back to what he was doing before.
Yeah. Yeah. It's so funny because they still come out to his fucking, I mean, Alter Bridge is basically his band at this point to wrestling fans. So right. You like always remember it every time they come out, which is just, he left a stamp on it, I guess.
He did. And I mean, it's kind of cool though to hear Alter Bridge on two different shows.
Yeah.
Two different companies, I should say.
More Alter Bridge, the better is something that I've always said about wrestling. Right.
Creed. And Creed, right. I was going to say, right before we came on air, I was giving actually a history lesson, because if no one knows, Mark Tremonti, the guitarist and the drummer, which his name escapes me, of Alter Bridge, they're actually former members of Creed. They went on to create Alter Bridge with Miles Kennedy.
I can hear the people turning off as we speak. With arms wide open. I was singing
I was just actually about to go, with arms wide open under the sunlight.
When we were changing rooms on here, I went to go take a piss, and I just subconsciously started singing it as I was in the bathroom. And
look, Creed is that one band that no one's going to admit that they listen to, but they listen to it every single time. Like, more so than Nickelback. Like, Nickelback can get hate and be, there's some justification there, but like, everyone listens to Creed. Dad Rock Anthem.
Oh no, they're great. I love butt rock. Big, big butt rock guy. Look, I'm not going to judge you for listening to Creed, but speaking of judging, we got Judgment Day. We're not just dressed like this for no reason. I mean,
we are.
It's related to the pay-per-view known as Judgment Day 2003. So you gotta, I mean, it's fresh in your mind.
It is.
Thoughts on what you witnessed with this pay-per-view?
Judgment Day, I feel like, was a weird time period. I actually, like, I don't know, like, it was like, I don't want to say a transitionary pay-per-view, but it felt like a weird time period in professional wrestling, because you had the O2s, which were like rock solid, but like this 03 time period, I feel like you got like Brock established, you got some things going on, but like, it definitely feels like we're moving to a different era. I don't know. I don't know how to explain it.
No, we definitely are. I mean, Stone Cold is done. Had his last match, I mean, for 20 years. Rock's gone. And then you got guys like Cena and Brock getting established. Like, you were talking about La Resistance and all the tag teams they're bringing in. So it's a very, I mean, if you look at like Judgment Day the previous year and now, it's a completely different product. I mean, it was headlined by Taker and Hulk Hogan, and we still get those guys here, but.
You know, that's a good way to say it, actually. I think 02, we were still kind of like, we still had Attitude Era influence. Mm-hmm. 03, it's like, we're gone from the Attitude Era, and it's very obvious now. Yeah. Very obvious. Yeah.
Yeah. No, it's, yeah, like I said, all the big stars from the Attitude Era are leaving. I mean, Goldberg's coming in. You got Kevin Nash. So there's like weird amalgamation between WCW and like the new WWE. So it's just a different vibe. And yeah, man. So it's 2003 is a weird time. I wouldn't say it's particularly great. SmackDown's great in 2003. Raw, man, I'm watching these Raws.
Raw. I never realized it at the time. You're right. You're 100% right that SmackDown was whooping Raw's ass. Yeah, but like, I never realized at that time, because I was such a Raw fan, that I didn't realize how bad it was until looking back, when I'm like, man, like, Scott Steiner is in a tag team here.
Right.
And like, he had just debuted, what, not even 6 months before, and he's been relegated to this at this point.
Was fighting for the world title like 3 or 4 months before this, right. And now he's losing to La Resistance. But we'll get to that, I suppose, to fluff us up a little bit. But
are you a fluffer?
I'm more of a fluffy generally.
Okay,
but I tend to fluff every now and then.
I mean, hey, dude, I'm looking for work, so let me know if you need a.
I mean, I'm definitely a grower, not a shower, if that's what you're asking.
It's sweatpants season, so you better get to work on that. So.
Nah, you can't see anything in the sweatpants for me. But speaking of wieners, we got, I don't have a segue for that, but the show opens up and
Speaking of wieners, that's what I was going to do for you.
Well, who's the guy with the small wiener and the sweatpants, huh?
Your Donovan, that's Sylvain Grenier's penis.
What's up with this set here? Is this just the Armageddon set, but with a Judgment Day logo on it?
Yeah, I thought the same thing. I was like, what is this set? Because it's that same like Armageddon 02 stuff. Yeah. So good eye on that, because that is exactly the same thing I thought.
Yeah.
And yeah.
Because
that's how spoiled we are, by the way, because we're like, they reused the set. It's like, they literally use the same set in the modern era.
Right.
For everything now. So, I mean, yeah.
No, because I remember this show, a lot of this show I remember. And I had been thinking like the stretcher match stuff was in Armageddon 03. But then like, I thought about, because you posted something a while ago. It was the Rey Mysterio stretcher spot with Big Show. And you said it was at Backlash 2003. And I saw that. I was like, I don't think that would make sense in the timeline. But then I forgot. Timeline.
Okay, that makes sense why you, because I remember you actually disputing that. And I'm like, no, I remember, because it was the pay-per-view before Judgment Day.
Yeah, yeah.
And so I vividly remembered it. Now that makes sense of why you argued it. Because if it was Armageddon 02, the previous pay-per-view would have been Survivor Series.
Right. Because I remember the stretcher match happening with that set in the background. So,
but. Yeah.
This is just all the important things that we pay attention to.
Yeah, you know, old couples always just argue and
they do. Yeah. Well, we got Stone Cold Steve Austin here, the co-GM of Monday Night Raw. He was fired by Eric Bischoff after WrestleMania for a few weeks. But Eric Bischoff was running amok. I mean, he caused JR to quit. I mean, the asylums were going, not the asylums. What's the thing? The inmates were running the asylum. Inmates were
running the asylum, yeah.
And Linda McMahon came back, thank God, to hire a 50-50.
We missed her. We missed her.
We did. We did. And
I really hope an unmasked Kane just like tombstones her ass in a couple months.
Well, that's a really awful thing to wish on somebody. Now that might just happen, as crazy as it sounds. Well, Linda's here. Linda's queer. Well, she's not here. She might be queer, though. I don't know. But
get used to it.
So 50-50 co-GMs, and that's going to be our running thread throughout the show. But Stone Cold opens the show, basically just welcoming everybody to Judgment Day. Says he's not going to flap his gums. What? It's all that and all that shit. Not gonna
I'm not going to flap my gums. What? I'm just sitting in that skybox. What?
Because like, what? There's a lot of matches. What?
He didn't have to cut a promo after a while. Because like he had that millisecond to think every time people said what. My friend was pointing this out. Like literally, he just had to say like, up in the skybox. What? The skybox. What? With a chili dog. What? Couple beers. What? And it's just like you just...
It's going with it. So good, man. So good.
In a good way, right?
Yeah. But yeah, he goes to his skybox, says he's gonna watch all the matches from his what do you call it, redneck heaven or something?
I don't remember, but yes, he called it something like his redneck point of view or something.
Walks up there.
I'm gonna have to
and is like, how many beers do you think are in that sky? There are cases upon cases of Miller Lights, and they're tall boys, too.
Redneck Heaven, by the way. It is called Redneck Heaven.
There we go. There we go.
Yeah.
And then he walks up there, and John Cena comes out, which is just a funny little moment of, like, Stone Cold walking off and then Cena's music cutting it. It was, like, kind of... I know they didn't mean for it to be, like...
Yes.
Yeah. But...
Yeah.
New era here. Nothing says new era of wrestling. Like Spanky teaming up with Chris Benoit and Rhino to take on the team of John Cena and the FBI, represented here by Chuck Palumbo and Johnny Stamboli.
Can we talk? I didn't even realize Cena. I'm so used to him being a babyface. I forgot he was a heel at this time. Because the FBI came out, I thought he was fighting the FBI. And then I was like, oh my God, he's teaming with the freaking FBI.
Right.
Like, it's crazy.
Yeah. Do you like his rap?
I did. I had written it down somewhere.
Well,
something about your girlfriend. Go ahead, go ahead.
No, I was about to say I have one line that I think he said.
Okay, go ahead.
Tony, like a Godfather flick. Your girl likes Italian sausage because she swallowed my
dick. Man.
Oh, wait. That's what that meant?
Oh, I don't know. Did you have another guess?
Because she swallowed my Italian sausage. I thought there was like spaghetti. Okay. I just found out what customs were in professional wrestling. So, I mean, hey, look, I'm innocent. But speaking of innocent, just in case anybody's listening to this and doesn't understand early 2000s lingo, can we talk about the fact that a man, Brian Kendrick, was allowed to be called a Spanky on air? Spanky being a reference to plungers, right?
Oh, well, they already had that gimmick. So you're saying that Brian Kendrick is he's a reincarnation of TL Hopper, perhaps?
I am because look, all I can think of is the fact that Brian Kendrick was on air as Spanky, as in he spanks his meat.
I mean,
and they allowed it.
Is that what it means? I mean, it could have another meaning, right? Like,
no, because there was something on Confidential where they're like, he goes, I don't know how many times a day I masturbate, but like, I was like, oh my God, he really is just talking about Spanky, being Spanky.
Do you think Vince McMahon knew what Spanky meant?
That's what I'm getting at. I don't think that Vince probably knew.
Yeah.
Could you imagine Vince sitting there going like, later on being like, what? He beats up how many times a day?
Well, maybe that's why he didn't. Because, I mean, he's not there for long, right? I mean, he comes back. Doesn't he get fired and then come back with Paul London?
I don't know. He at least got repackaged as just Brian Kendrick later on.
Yeah.
Because remember, he was there and then later on with Paul London and things like that. So, I mean, I don't know if he did get let go technically.
Yeah.
I think he did. And then came back as just Brian Kendrick.
I want to say, I think he had like a brief ROH run in between and then came back. Right. I could be wrong.
Right. So if you're a Spanky fan, just let us know. Let us know.
Or just a fan of spanking. Right. Send us pictures or whatever. I don't know. Speaking of Ring of Honor, do you know the FBI was also in Ring of Honor? As well as ECW, obviously. So
I know about ECW because yeah, of course. Let's talk about Sal Graziano, you know. Let's give credit to JT Smith. Mm. You know, let's give credit to Big Guido.
Big Guido, Salvatore Bellomo, I just watched
Tony Mamaluke.
Tony Mamaluke.
Oh, let's all right.
Taz, I don't know. But yeah, so a faction that's transcended factions has transcended. I mean, they were just an Impact, I think, like recently. So it stood the test of time. Are you a big fan of the FBI?
Yeah. So I actually saw them at Hardcore Justice, TNA Hardcore Justice 2010. Mm. I used to go to those shows a lot. And speaking of which, TNA is back. So we got TNA coming back. I feel good being able to say that again, by the way, TNA,
yes.
As opposed to like mentally going, ah, crap, it's Impact.
Right. Yeah.
You know, because I would do that all the time, just like when I'm like talking about a woman and I'm like, I kind of like men, but yeah.
What? I thought I knew where you were going, but you zigged what I thought you were going to say.
I didn't know where I was going with that either, brother.
Just gotta let the words kind of fall out of you sometimes. I get it.
Someone's going to snip that out and be like, you see, I knew it.
Among other things. I mean, the plunger. I mean, it's just, this is, you know.
Please don't air this.
This is just my private collection, you know?
Yeah, thank you. Thank you. Your customs, if you will.
Yes, of course. Well, I don't think this was a Spanky custom because he just gets his ass kicked during this whole match, which, I mean, it's probably like a 3-minute match. This is, I think Benoit and Rhino each got like one move apiece.
Right, they just destroyed them. Cena wasn't really even part of this match. FBI took most of the brunt, right?
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting. I don't remember FBI being pushed like this. In my mind, they were like a lower tier jobber tag team, but I mean, they've been taken. They took out The Undertaker. They took out Nathan Jones. By gosh. By gosh.
Thank God for that one, though.
Yeah. So they do some good. And they pin.
They kiss Rikishi.
Do they kiss Rikishi?
Hold on. So it's an Italian thing, right? The whole kiss of death. You know?
That made me laugh, though, that their finisher is called the Kiss of Death. They hit the KOD right, on Spanky.
Ah, there you go. So, but they literally did kiss Rikishi. It's in their Titantron.
Oh.
Search that. FBI Titantron.
Okay.
I'm not if you want to see, because it's a short Titantron, so it keeps looping. Mm-hmm. So you just see Nunzio just kissing Rikishi over and over.
Well, that's all I need, actually. That can get me there.
Right. If you need some ASMR, like, to sleep, FBI Titantron.
I mean, I just use your voice for that.
I know.
Well, KOD on Spanky, just like a backbreaker leg the drop of sorts.
The kiss of death on Spanky.
Bianca Belair, you owe some money to old Johnny Stamboli, I think. But right. That's Red beside Rum. The point. Red Rum, indeed.
Well, Relic. Sorry, Relic.
Hey, did you know that Relic is killer spelled backwards?
Didn't know that.
Blew your mind. To me.
Yeah. That's an old school meme, sir.
Oh, I bet you. Oh, fuck, he was Relic. I didn't think about why you said that.
100%.
Yeah, now Relic. I remember that now. He's gonna knock my drinks over.
See, I'm actually a TNA fan. Like, I know a lot of people think I'm like a WWE mark, but I'm like, I actually watch like the TNA all rules. The companies. Yeah.
But Relic gets the win here. And Spanky was also in TNA. But yeah, that happens. Again, it's a quick squash match, but I mean, it was whatever. Benoit does his headbutt, Rhino does the gore, but then the FBI wins. Bada bing, bada boom. You know what I'm saying? Italian sausage. So, but speaking of which, we're back at the skybox. Stone Cold Redneck Steve Austin heaven. Gobbling down some glizzies in the skybox. And
he's going to town on them glizzies too.
Eric Bischoff wanted none of the glizzy. He walks in because, you know, 50-50,
It's Steve's skybox. It's Eric's skybox. So they share all everything that's in all the beer, all the food. Steve, he offers him a hot dog, and Bischoff is just bewildered at what he put in his hand. It's like he's never seen a hot dog in his life. The hot dog! And he eats it.
He's like, what are these pores doing here?
I know, right?
Like, that was definitely like the look he gave.
Well, I mean, he doesn't even want to drink beer. He wants a scotch and water. He wants a martini, but all they got is Miller Lite tall boys. So, but yeah.
What?
Bischoff wants it poured in a glass. And can you? All right.
I'm going to have to close this door. Just fat ass.
Hey, man, I'm still here.
No.
I was gonna.
You're not going to edit out the thighs, are you? Because that was magnificent.
I mean, I was thinking about maybe just making this my new posture. I am wearing pants, by the way. It looks like I'm not wearing pants. Or am I?
Brother.
Well, speaking of no pants.
Ooh, who's this guy with all the thigh meat?
Art Donovan, that's Lex Luger. No, Art Donovan, that's Rene Dupree. Because he's in this next man, the thighs and the La Resistance are nothing to mess with, and as well as Scott Steiner and Test, because we got a tag team contest next. When I think of Raw in 2003, I honestly think of like these four. I think of the team of Scott Steiner and Test versus La Resistance. Man, debut pay per view match for the Frenchmen. And why did we hate the French in 2003?
Didn't it have something to do with the war or something? And like them not wanting to fight or help or some shit?
Is that what I guess?
I don't know. You see, I never got into like the bullshit about the like, I hate France. But I do remember like Scott Steiner doing that promo, which I think they showed when he was talking about go back to Canada or France. Same thing.
Yeah, he was debating Chris Nowinski. It was literally like they were talking about like the conflict in Iran, I think it was, or something. It was literally that, like there was no wrestling angle behind it. And they're just trying to, Scott Steiner was kind of floundering. So they were trying to do a, you know, support the troops, cheer for me, but it didn't really work.
Yeah.
And then the French,
even in 03, it didn't work. Put it, think about it. Like when patriotism was like at an all time high.
Right. And that's really, I mean, La Resistance. I mean, they were fine. They were just generic foreign heels, I thought.
I liked them. I don't know. I had a soft spot for, or maybe not too soft when they came around. I had a soft spot for La Resistance. I thought, like, for their ages, because, like, Rene Dupree's, like, a whopping 19 years old here.
Yeah.
And Sylvain Grenier is, like, 26. I'm like, for, like, younger dudes in the business, I'm like, they're, you know, they did pretty well. They killed Spike Dudley.
Well, that's something.
All right. I liked them. I don't know. Like, I'm telling you, I went to a couple events during that time, and I marked out when they came out. I will tell you that much.
It was a silent arena, and just the voice.
Yeah!
Just that first beat. Well, you're just a big beret guy, I think.
That's what it is.
Yeah. Who was...
That reminds me of Pat Patterson, but anyway.
Of course. One of the guys, like, started wrestling in the beret. I don't know if that was the intention. I don't remember really, like, the long tights and the tassel around the waist.
Are you talking about Sylvain when he was the Montreal ambassador?
I mean, in this match, one of the guys started out wearing the beret. Yeah, I mean, it didn't last long because it's a fucking beret, and Scott Steiner punches him.
Like, I must have missed that.
If you blinked, you would have missed it, but...
I did.
How dare you. Well, we got Test, and then on top of that, we got the Test and Scott Steiner thing with Stacy Keibler. Test, you know, the testicles. Stacy's
great gimmick, by the way.
It's something.
Can we bring him up to speed with that? Like, they had said Test was boring or something, so he literally Stacy Keibler tries to market him and say, like, his fans are called testicles. So it became like a good baby face. But then, like, here he's getting jealous because Stacy's paying attention to Scott Steiner.
Mm.
And so these are, like, the seeds of his heel turn.
Yes.
So, yeah.
Yeah.
So basically, his testicles were very unhappy at this time.
A little blue, a little asymmetrical. No, we all go through it, man. I'm with you. Yeah,
absolutely.
Scott Steiner, who also probably has really small balls, is teaming with Test. And, boy, the...
the miscommunication is just a plenty with this one, let me tell you. Test hits the pump handle slam on Sylvain. But Stacy's on the apron. She's arguing with the ref about something. Test has him pinned, but he starts yelling at Stacy, and then Test gets drop kicked into Stacy, and Stacy falls off the apron, but Scott Steiner catches her. Oh, it's just a comedy of errors, Kenneth. Let me tell you.
What a match.
What a match.
You must have loved this match since you love both teams so much.
Yeah. Oh, we're not even close to done here, buddy, because Scott Steiner makes the blind tag. And then he gets in there, he wrecks shop, and then Test goes for the big boot onto one of the Frenchmen, but they move, and then Test boots Steiner. They get rid of Test, and then they hit their flapjack onto Scott Steiner. La Resistance does for the win. So the Frenchmen get their win in their first pay-per-view match, beating a guy who was fighting for the world title just a few months ago. And
being a former WCW world champion just underside of 2 years ago.
Right.
So, like, crazy.
That's where we're at. And Stacy's checking on Scott to make sure he's okay. And then Tess's like, "Hey, Stacy, come over here," and he pulls her out. So,
is he drunk?
He's Canadian.
I see.
That's another element of this. It's like, oh, it's USA versus the French. Actually, it's one Canadian versus Canadian French.
I never even thought about that. It's literally like one American versus, yeah, wow, okay. I never thought about that.
Yeah, I mean, it's the icing on the cake.
Tess was never marketed, well, I was about to make a grave error. I was going to say Tess was never really marketed as Canadian.
As an un-American.
Literally part of the un-Americans like 2 years before this, or a year before this.
Yeah, not even, it was like October. This is, yeah, probably like 6 months before this, so.
Yeah.
Well, that's a thing that happened on this show. So we're off to a hot start, I think.
Right.
But who's going to get us on track? Well, none other than Mr. America, who's backstage. He's walking
this
around.
He's jacked. This guy's yoked.
Great mustache on the fella.
Yeah.
Something, I look at him, I'm like, this guy would never be racist ever. You know?
No. But no. Something about him makes me think, like, you know, I could see him like headlining Madison Square Garden or something. Something about him. I'm surprised they didn't do more with him, to be honest with you.
Yeah. So you're saying he was underrated, perhaps underutilized, this Mr. America?
I think it's kind of like Mason Ryan. You know how like Mason Ryan, they kept like comparing him to Batista, so he never got out of that shadow?
Uh-huh.
Yeah, like for some reason, they keep mentioning like Hulk Hogan. And I'm like, yeah. I don't see it. Like, I see the star potential in him, but like, I don't see why they keep like comparing him to Hulk Hogan.
Yeah, because like Hulk Hogan wears red and yellow.
Right, exactly.
And this guy wears red, white, and blue. Like, they're not even the same colors. So
right, and not only that, but like the nipple displacement, it's like a little, like 2 inches off.
Right. Where Hogan's is. Yeah. The pythons were 22 inches instead of 24 inches.
Or 23.9 inches.
Yeah.
So he didn't have it just the same as Hogan.
Right. Yeah. Maybe one day. Maybe one day he'll make a return.
He'll get there. He'll get there, but hopefully.
Maybe in TNA or something. I don't know. Or maybe he could own it. Maybe he could lead them to going to war with WWE.
As long as he gets rid of that crappy Six Sides brother.
Yeah. Well, we also got... So Mr. America runs into Gregory Helms, ace reporter for the Daily Globe.
I love this segment. Dude,
this made me so happy. It was so stupid, but I loved it.
Yeah.
And by the way, I feel like they on pay-per-views, they don't do this stuff. Like these little silly backstage segments, and maybe it's for good reason. I don't know. But like even like the inter-promotional Raw and SmackDown kind of little
that's
quick
what I was
little things.
Say, yeah. Yeah. Because this was literally Raw's, correct me if I'm wrong, Raw's Gregory Helms and the SmackDowns. Yes. Yeah, so it was just like a quick little interaction backstage that normally wouldn't happen. And so, like, yeah, I thought it was like good. The one thing I liked about Judgment Day, there was like some good in between segments. There's some good segues into like in between the matches.
Yeah. Yeah. Now I'm just like, my sources indicate that you're Hulk Hogan. And then Hulk Hogan's like, oh dude, let me tell
hold
you something.
Hold on. Who was like, what? Said Hulk Hogan was like,
oh, and then Mr. America was like, yeah, because Helms was saying that he was Hulk Hogan. So I was
exactly
my wires got crossed a little bit.
I don't want you to misspeak. That's all.
I would look very silly if that would be
I don't want
case.
You to misspeak. Like, could you imagine if someone's like, I don't want you to date my daughter, dude? Like, that's just
that would
yeah,
be awful.
Don't misspeak.
Yeah.
Terrible.
Well, then Mr. America was like, well, dude, let me tell you something. I think you're the Hurricane Brother. And then that's the whole thing. You know the deal. Speaking of segments that I liked, after that, we cut to Eddie Guerrero in his locker room. Chavo Guerrero is injured, which is, you know, another thing I like. So Eddie Guerrero.
Do you hate Chavo too? Like, he stinks, like,
man.
I don't like Chavo. Like, you know, we all have our like, and look here, look, if Chavo's listening, it's nothing against your abilities or anything, man. It's just, you're just my one. You know, you all have the one wrestler that's just like, you wanted more out of them and they didn't give it to you.
I guess being next to Eddie Guerrero your whole career kind of, it's a big shadow.
That is tough.
Big shadow.
That is tough. That's like me next to you.
Right. We'll let people interpret that how they will. But so Eddie,
especially from the postures.
So Los Guerreros, they, I mean, they've been stealing, they've been lying, they've been cheating, all of the things from a Team Angle. They stole the medals of Kurt Angle. They've, you know, stolen a portrait of Kurt Angle. They've just been a thorn in their side, some may say.
They've stolen my heart.
Yes. Heart throbs. And Chavo is injured. So Eddie has to find a replacement partner for this upcoming ladder match for the tag team titles. And who better than Canyon? No, who better than Tajiri? And just like the energy of these two guys at like reacting off of each other just made me.
Were you watching it this time? And I'm asking for a reason.
I had watching, like just gotten back. I had like taken a year and a half off or so, but this is like when I was just getting back in. But yes, I was watching this.
So what was your perspective on the whole like Eddie Guerrero to Jerry team?
I mean, it felt random very much, but I mean, I was a fan of it at the time, I think.
Right. And so that's what I was going to get at. It's like, if you're looking back on this and you look at it, I almost want everyone to understand that, like, this is kind of one of those things where they put them together for no reason, but, like, they did really well together to the point where I liked Eddie Guerrero and Tajiri better than Los Guerrero because they were so funny. Like, Tajiri comes out dressed like a Chicano at one point. And here's a little Easter egg if you can find it. Go try to find that Titantron. Because they edited Los Guerrero's Titantron and put Tajiri's head in there too with the whole, you know, the whole graphic. And it's hilarious. It's just Los Guerrero's and Tajiri. And he's like doing that number. You know? Yeah. Like, oh my God. So fond memories of this tag team.
We lie, we cheat, we steal, I say. That's Tajiri. That was my Asian accent. I'm Asian. I can't do an Asian accent.
Same. My mother would be very disappointed in me.
Yeah. Well, I was not disappointed in this next match. The good segue, right? We got the WWE tag team titles on the line in a ladder match. We got Team Angle, of course, Charlie Haas and Shelton Benjamin taking on Eddie Guerrero and Tajiri. I thought this match was fun. It was the ladder I felt like was used as a weapon in a good way rather than like a base for like all the gymnastics like it is in current times, but I liked it. That was pretty hard hitting. I feel like that's kind of the story they were trying to tell, is like Eddie's the only one that's been in a ladder match. And Team Angle were so much like the opposite. Like they're the mat based guys. So they kind of had this fish out of water kind of vibe going, like the hilariously slow climbs up the ladder and not knowing like how to fucking.
Well, they're shooters. How would they know how to climb a ladder?
Exactly. You know, just completely foreign to them. They have never had to change a light bulb in their life, I guess.
No. Not at the University of Minnesota.
No, they don't have light bulbs, I think. You know?
So. No, because they have stars like Brock Lesnar.
Come on, this guy. Check him out.
That's right. That's right.
So what'd you think of this match, man? I thought it was pretty fun.
This was fun. This is one of those things where I think Eddie Guerrero probably was the ring general here, and it showed. Oh, yeah. Because it was like one of those things where I think Eddie Guerrero is so underrated in terms of ladder matches. I think, like, you know, you got the Hardys, you got the Dudleys, Edge of Christian, but it's like Eddie's ladder matches were so different, so different than like the other ones, where, like you said, they utilized the ladder in such a way that it was like, it wasn't just like, oh, I'm just going to slam somebody with it. It's like, how creative can we get with it?
Right.
And there was a spot here where Tajiri does this little, I don't know if they ever have a name for it, but where he bounces off the ropes.
The handspring,
the handspring elbow, right? But he does it into the ladder.
That's awesome.
Which I thought that was a badass spot. And because it was safe too, like Jajiri just kind of hit the ladder. And that's what I'm getting at. It's like, you know, if we're approaching this in you know, a real sense, I'm like, it was pretty safe ladder work, but it was like damn good looking too.
Yeah.
So yeah.
Yeah. Making me
I really like this match. I really liked it. It might have been my favorite on the card.
Yeah, I mean, it was, I mean, the there were some pretty brutal spots too. Like Eddie did his helo, you know, over the top rope, but had Charlie Haas in between two ladders. Haas, I just typed Haas yam bag. I think he got like a ladder to the dick or something at some point.
I hope so.
I hope that's what that means. But
you know, some people pay for things like that.
Yeah, I wouldn't know. I wouldn't know.
I paid for that one.
Dude, the Team Angle, I don't know what their tag team finisher, if it has a name either, but it's, you know, Charlie holds the guy up on the ropes and then Shelton jumps over him, but they did it on the ladder, off a ladder Shelton came off of.
Yeah.
So good. So good.
Wow. Team Angle was so, so good. I mean, it's funny, I hated Team Angle at the time because I had seen some dark matches with Shelton Benjamin where he did this whole, it's all about the Benjamins. And I was like, I wanted him like that. Uh-huh. And then when he debuted as Team Angle, I almost held a grudge against them because I was like, I wanted Shelton as a singles guy.
Right.
You know, so anyway, so at the time, yeah, I didn't appreciate Team Angle enough because Team Angle was really good. Mm-hmm. Really good.
Yeah. And they were holding it down. New. Super new because they, I mean, obviously Kurt Angle, their leader, is out with an injury at this point. So they pretty much got to hold it down by themselves. And I feel like they held their own.
They came in as like, imagine like, you know, how Edge had Hawkins and Ryder as like his edge heads,
right?
Like they came in that kind of role, but imagine if like Edge went down with an injury and then they were just left to fend for themselves. That's exactly what happened here with Team Angle. It's like they're literally called Team Angle wearing Kurt Angle's attire and using his song,
right?
And now Kurt Angle's gone, and so they're left to his name and still having to hold that on TV. So, I mean, that's a tough spot to be in, but they did it well.
I mean, just like how upset they got when the Guerreros stole his medals and they have the portrait of Kurt watching their match. Oh, it's just so good. And like working with the Guerreros kind of forced them to kind of come out of their shell as characters too. So,
well, I mean, sidebar, I heard Shelton Benjamin talk on an interview with Chris Van Vliet about how Eddie hated them at the time, about how they had to work with them all the time. And he's like, I don't hold it against them because we were green as goose shit. Mm-hmm. And, you know, but one day I think Shelton basically said he stood up for himself and said, like, what's your fucking problem? This is this and this. And then Eddie backed down because he respected him from there, which was like he wasn't just going to let him run all over him.
Yeah.
So, I mean, these were the kind of matches, you know, where I'm sure, you know, they did good backstage, but then Eddie would chew them out of like, you need to do this in this spot, Holmes, to do this and do that, you know? Mm-hmm. So he's a perfectionist, man, but that's why he was so great.
Yeah. And made everybody better. He worked with as well. Eddie's throwing out his sunset powerbomb off the ladder. Frog splashes off the ladder.
Amazing. Watch this back. If you don't want to watch Judgment Day 03, go watch this one match back.
Yeah.
It's no coincidence that his singles run starts a little bit after this. You know what I mean? It's no coincidence because this is his ascension to the main event right here in this time period.
Yeah. Cause they bring back the US title. I think it's the next pay-per-view, which Eddie wins, I believe. So he's just off to the races. And, but in this match, Eddie Guerrero and Tajiri get the win when Eddie's climbing the ladder. He's reaching for the belt. Shelton tries to pull him down from behind, but Tajiri from the other side of the ladder throws the green mist into the eyes of Shelton between Eddie's legs, which allows them to grab the titles, which is just an awesome creative finish.
That's what I mean. Tajiri doesn't get enough love. He was great at comedy character, but he was like very explosive in the ring.
Yeah.
Very, very good.
And he could shift to that, like, just brutal, just kick your head off kind of guy too, with like the cruiserweight division.
That's what I mean. Yeah.
Yeah.
And I mean, just look at this though. Like, he was literally doing what, velocity matches, nothing much, and then gets thrown into the role of like being Eddie's partner, replacing Chavo, becomes tag team champion, and like it was accepted by the fan base, as in like he did,
right?
He was just so good. You know, not a lot of guys could do that. You could just throw him in a makeshift team and win the titles and then be like, here's the tag team.
Yeah. No, he's one of the most underrated guys of all time, Tajiri, for sure.
Right.
But they're the tag team champions, and you guessed it, we're back to the Skybox. We got Bischoff and Steve Austin. Oh, the hijinks just ensues, let me tell you. Bischoff's drinking beer, he's eating a cheeseburger. He says he's stuffed because I guess Austin's trying to make him eat a lot for whatever reason.
Austin's stuffing him, right, right.
Yeah. Austin's stuffing him and apparently thinks that Bischoff drinks beer like a sissy, which I'm watching this and I'm like, I think that's how I drink beer. So I mean, how do you drink beer? You know,
funny, my daughter, because, you know, I'm watching this to do this podcast.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, you know, just parenting 101. It's like she walks by when the word sissy is said and she goes, Dad, what's a sissy? And I'm like, and I was just like, it was so hard to explain to her. I'm like, it's a slang term that was in the early 2000s. I was like, it's not relevant anymore. Mm. And I was trying to explain to her and be like calm about it. You know what I mean? And not like kind of tell her what it is.
Yeah, I guess sissy kind of died off, huh? You don't get a lot of sissies nowadays.
Right. Exactly.
Sometimes when I have to go to the bathroom, I say I have to go take a sissy. Just a fun fact about me, you know? Well, we got Steve Austin and Eric Bischoff in the Skybox. Excuse me. He grabs a mic. He has a mic handy with him. He opens the window. He's like, if you think Eric Bischoff drinks like a sissy, give me a hell yeah. And everybody does it. It's fun stuff. Yeah. And the hits just keep on coming. We got Chris Jericho backstage. And who interrupts him? You guessed it. Rowdy Roddy Piper. Do you think these guys actually don't like each other? I kind of got that vibe from this interaction.
I got the vibe that, yeah, Piper was kind of like, the vibe, he's like, you're a young person. Like, he's like, you're trying to steal the Piper's pit, and I don't like it. I was like, that kind of sounds like real. But it's also one of those things where I think, like, Piper was like, everything was real to him, too.
You know,
he's like one of those guys, like, where he wouldn't want a job because he's like, this guy's an outsider, and I don't want a job for him. And,
yeah,
you know, so, like, Piper was a different animal, but that's also why, like, arguably he never got championships, never got anything, because he was hard to do business with.
A little rough around the edges, perhaps.
Yeah. And one day I'll get a I wanted to try a Piper impression so bad there, but like I couldn't, because he's got, you gotta go crazy.
What the fuck? Sounds like Piper getting electrocuted.
Right.
Scottish is a hard one, but it's also the worst accent, you know?
Is it a Scottish? He does not have a Scottish accent, sir.
Is he not Scottish?
Okay, character-wise, but I feel like his character doesn't have a Scottish accent. He just kind of talks like this.
Roddy is Roddy Piper.
Scottish. He's Canadian.
That's kind of the
same
thing.
If you really
thing,
want
right?
to know what he actually is, he's Canadian. But Les, no, I'm talking, no, listen to what I'm saying. His character is Scottish.
Right.
But what I'm saying is his voice, it's not like he put on the Scottish accent. He just put on a normal voice.
Saskatoon, Saskatchewan. That's kind of like the, yeah. I could see
that's
it.
That's made
yeah.
up. Yeah,
made up. I think, isn't that where Brock Lesnar lives? No, he lives in the...
Exactly, it's made up. Yeah, he doesn't want people to know where he lives.
You got a good point there. Well, Piper's here. Yeah, you said it. They have the Piper's Pit versus Highlight Reel Deal, and... Piper's
promotional again.
Yes.
I mean, again, fun stuff of like interpromotional battles, you know?
Stuff you wouldn't see on the normal TV show they're giving you on paper.
Right. Here. Right.
Piper's like, you ripped it off. And then Jericho's makes reference to how Piper ripped off the leg of Zach Gowen on SmackDown. And at the time, Piper was like, it's an accident. Just like you being born, he says, you know, how
Jesus
Jericho's
Lord.
Parents should have wore a condom. And that's where we're at. That's where we're at.
I'm just mad about Sean O'Hare at this point, because like he's just Piper's bitch boy. When like this is that time period where they tried to re-debut him with the like cheat on your wife.
Yes.
Cheat on your taxes. Do stuff. He's like, I'm not telling you anything you don't already know. And I don't know if they just thought he couldn't pull off that character, but like, I remember watching those vignettes and we're like, oh, they got something here. And then, I mean, this is what, a month later, and he's already relegated to like just Piper's bitch boy.
Right. Yeah. He's very much secondary to Piper. Like, cause I remember the pairing, but like, and watching these shows, it's like, cause in my head, it was like Sean O'Hare was the focal point and Piper was behind him, but it's definitely the opposite. Like Sean O'Hare is just, like you said,
right here, it's like a complete opposite. And I'll give you a little fun tidbit just cause I'm full of them.
Oh boy.
So, Sean O'Hare was, friends with a band that actually made his theme song called Come On. The band was named Waterproof Blonde. If that name sounds familiar, it's because they went on to make Christian's song, Just Close Your Eyes.
Yes.
So the reason Christian has that song, or even knows, or WWE worked with that band, is because of Sean O'Hare.
Oh. So that's contribution to...
That's his contribution, right?
I don't know, man. He just has such a cool look.
Right. A unique had style. I always, even back in the WCW days, always thought like Sean O'Hare had something to him. He was, what, 6'6"? You know what I mean? He's a big guy. And at the time, you know, that spiked out look with, he had it. He had it down. Great athleticism. He used to do, which I love this one. He used to do Jeff Hardy's move, right? The Swanton, but he called it the Shanton Bomb.
That's fun.
Right.
That's fun.
It literally just, because he's 6'6", it was very impressive looking how he did it. You know, so yeah, I just watched, no, but in all seriousness, I want to show, and he's no longer with us, but shout out to Sean O'Hare, man, because like that, he should have been something in the business, man. Guy had it.
I mean, that's a top of my list of like untapped potential for sure.
Same.
Unfortunately.
Same. Yeah.
But more on Sean and Piper later. But before that, we got ourselves an Intercontinental title battle royal for the dormant IC title. They got rid of it in what, October, I think, something like that.
I just posted this today. I mean, this will probably spoil when we're recording, what day we're recording it, but I literally just posted it just as a hint of what I was doing a little bit later today. Do you want to give us like the backstory on like why the Intercontinental, like, because like that, I actually had forgotten, because they backtrack on this one quick.
Yeah, because so it was in that transition period when Raw and SmackDown were both trying to find their identities in terms of like what titles were on each brand.
Right.
Kane was the then Intercontinental Champion when this is all during the Katie Vick stuff.
And that part I forgot. So someone pointed that out, like, oh, we got the Katie Vick storyline out of that. And I was like, oh my God, we did.
Right.
I forgot that that was when the Katie Vick stuff happened.
I mean, it was very much like a background thing, like the IC titles and in no way a focal point of the whole story.
Right.
How could it
exactly.
be? But it was, you know, Kane versus Triple H, who was the world champion, and it was a unification match. But the fact that it was a unification match was very much like it was a non-factor. I mean, you had the Katie Vick story and the world title.
You got to go back just a little bit because it was a strange time period where they, like, I guess they felt like they had too many titles.
Yes.
And so like I don't remember the order, so don't get me on this, but I think they had combined the IC with the European and then the IC with the hardcore. So technically those titles were unified into the Intercontinental title. And then they decided to go too far and then merge the Intercontinental with the World Heavyweight title. So now we have no mid-card title on Raw.
Right.
Which is crazy.
Which is why we have debates, and which is why we have, I mean, whatever the hell. I can't even tell you anything else is happening on Raw. Just a bunch of non-fat. You had the stupid shit with Bischoff and Sean Morley and the Dudleys, and then they're a part of them. That was just like monopolizing all the time on Raw for a while. But that the Sean Morley deal is over. Apparently,
I was going to say, you're right. Speaking of Sean Morley,
which, by the way, it was this, because I was watching this with my wife and she has just a very funny window of knowledge about wrestling, because I watch this era of stuff like when I'm falling asleep. And so she catches a little bit of it and she sees Val Venus come out, who's making his return, coming out with the towel. I mean, the music, the towel, the hello, ladies, like the whole thing.
And hello, ladies.
My wife was like, why is Sean Morley dressed like that? And it was at that point I realized I failed as a husband, because now she knows this guy as Chief Morley.
No, Sean Morley, right. I was going to say, that's not even his like main character. Chief Morley.
Yeah, or Morley or whatever she said. But it was so funny that she knew him as Morley and not Val Venus. But
can I say that's the best thing? And I don't mean this in a facetious way, but like I've watched wrestling with significant others. Uh-huh. And it's like, that is the best, is when like you get the perspective of a more casual fan that only watches because of you,
right,
say something that's just like out of pocket. Like I remember I had an ex go like, oh my God, why is Cody actually thinks he's Stardust now? And now there's like something going on and Dusty's this. Right. And I'm like, I'm sitting there like a proud, I'm so proud of her, like for figuring like the whole feud out. And then she was mad because like, she goes, I know I had done well because she goes, why is this match not happening at WrestleMania? This is a WrestleMania match. And I'm like,
that a girl,
I could marry you right now.
Well, I guess let's jump in a gun a bit because so they do this awesome video package, first of all, before the match, highlighting pretty much all of the Intercontinental champions in the past.
Why this title is so important, why they're bringing it back sort of thing, you know?
Highlighting the controversy, how it's, you know, Stone Cold and The Rock were fighting over it, the, throwing the title off the bridge. Like, it's been such a significant part of history, and the fact they just got rid of it was crazy. But the first champion, old Pat Patterson's out here bringing out the belt, and we'll end up presenting it to the winner, which is a nice little touch here. I mean, it was a battle royal, so it's also, it's all former Intercontinental champions with the exception of Booker T, who, like, I think commentary said that Steve Austin made a executive decision or whatever the hell. Yeah, so we got Lance Storm, Kane, Val Venus, Booker T, Chris Jericho, Christian, Rob Van Dam, Goldust, and Test pulling double duty here. I mean, I thought it was a fine little battle royal. Not too many people.
Right.
And they told a pretty good story at the tail end of it, but I don't know. What'd you make of it?
I mean, I think it was just there to get the Intercontinental champion. Like, it wasn't meant to be a good match as much as it was just like, can we have an Intercontinental champion? And then the stuff at the end is what establishes the feud for the title going forward. So that's about it. Like, the match itself, nothing to write home about. But, you know, obviously Booker being involved was for a reason. You know?
So, yeah. I mean, coming off of his feud with Triple H, he was kind of lost in the shuffle a little bit. So this gives him something to be a part of, I suppose. But Lance Storm gets thrown out immediately. Everybody else gangs up on Kane, throw him out. We got a lot of betrayals in this match. We got Booker T throwing out Goldust, former partners. We also got Christian throwing out Jericho as he goes for a lion salt. Christian like shoves him over, which is a fun spot. And we get down to Christian and Booker T are the final two. And there's a lot going on here. Correct me if I'm wrong. So somebody baseball slides the ref that's on the outside. I think it's Christian.
Right.
So ref's out.
So ref's out of commission. Yeah.
And they only have one ref, apparently.
Nobody else is watching this match.
Apparently. Nobody. Not one singular soul.
At least not one, anyone that works in an official capacity for WWE.
Right. Nobody relevant.
Right. The music guy's watching, though.
Oh, yeah. Because Booker T, you know, hits his axe kick off the apron to Christian. Knocks Christian out, and Booker T wins. The music plays, like you said, but the ref is still out, and apparently he's deaf as well.
And that's the first thought I had. I'm like, did they not hear the music?
Oh, he's unconscious, apparently. Has no senses about him. Christian's pissed. He goes out. Does he knock out Pat Patterson as well?
Yeah, because Pat Patterson goes to present Booker T with the title.
Right.
And so Christian gets into, like, don't know, punches Pat Patterson for no good reason. And then, yeah.
Grabs the belt. Christian does. Hits Booker T in the head with the belt. Tosses him over the top rope. And wouldn't you know it, the ref has come to. Sees this. Sees Christian horrible throwing timing out Booker. And calls for the bell. So Christian wins the Intercontinental Championship. I thought it was a funny little story at the end. And we're kind of given, I feel like it's at this point where Christian's finally like found footing, you know, because for a while he's with the Un-Americans and then just random tag teams here and there, but he's been getting the push recently.
I hate WWE though. I arguably liked Christian better than Edge.
Yeah.
And felt like he should have been world champion before Edge. But yeah, they never seemed to give Christian the love. And I mean, look, no coincidence, at least in my opinion, in my kayfabe, that Booker T grew up with a single mother. So he didn't have a father. And Christian, I think, took umbrage with this. I think, you know, he had a problem with that. And so obviously took it in his own hands to eliminate Booker T.
And it all circles back to Booker T's lack of fathership. That's what you're saying.
That's what I'm saying. Edge, his partner, didn't like him, turned on him. Edge had a single mom, didn't have a father.
I mean, Pat Patterson, I'm sure there's a lot of turmoil with him and his father back in the day.
I mean, I watched the Pat Patterson documentary, you know, he was one of many kids and yeah,
didn't have the love, at least, you know,
of his father. Right.
So Christian's really the good guy when you think about it.
Absolutely. And fun fact, have you seen the Christian return from 2009? The exact words that were uttered were what? Your dad can't save you now. And out comes Christian. So this is nothing new. There is a pattern with Christian here that we've not been paying attention to.
It's something that I'm going to keep an eye on for sure as I go through this timeline, because I'm sure you're right. I'm sure you're right. It's deep-rooted. But I guess the dad of the Intercontinental Championship is Christian, huh? That's something.
He's your daddy Intercontinental Championship.
What about Goldberg's dad? Does Goldberg have a dad? I'm sure at one point he did.
I don't know Goldberg's history.
Well, we're going to have to review it because Christian and Goldberg have been having a little mini feud before this.
Yeah, where was Goldberg in this?
That was the question I asked, because Goldberg, I mean, he beat The Rock at Backlash, was kind of a disaster. I mean, from the get-go, his run in 2003 was a disaster. And I don't know if it was intentional to cut. I mean, he would end up winning the world title, so they're not pushing him down the card. But yeah, I guess maybe they just didn't have a spot for him. But I mean, Christian and Goldberg had a steel cage match on Raw the week before this. So they were kind of had like, again, like a little mini feud on Raw. But it was very interesting that Goldberg wasn't on this pay-per-view. I don't know where you would slide him in. You throw him in there.
I guess the world title stuff. But yeah, maybe that's exactly why they didn't use him. Because it's like, where would you put Goldberg in this pay-per-view?
Right. Yeah, I mean, they're just... they have the Nash stuff going on, and I guess they're just kind of biding time for the eventual Goldberg world title. Exactly. But yeah, the new people's champ, Christian, which, by the way, that's a thing at this point. The Peeps is like early days.
I was going to say, people don't understand that the Peeps was a direct derivative of The Rock.
Mm-hmm.
It's because he was saying he was a new people's champ, and then, and that's why he did the Peeperoni.
The Peeperoni.
Yeah.
I love a Peeperoni pizza.
We all do.
But so Christian wins. I mean, I thought that match was pretty sable-licious, but speaking of which, we got
my favorite part of the event
a bikini competition. Tori Wilson versus Sable. So I should mention, so before the match, Sable stumbles upon Tori backstage, asks Tori if she's nervous. Tori says no. Sable says, can I use your oil? And then proceeds to oil her legs. And a lot going on here. Did you catch the tail of the tape?
I didn't.
Like this one?
I didn't. Ooh, there it is.
Which, am I wrong for laughing at? I laughed really hard when they showed this tail of the tape. And my wife was like, what's so funny? I'm like, they're showing the bust for a wrestling contest. I don't know, but so that's a thing.
It's a different time period, folks.
It's interesting what people thought was attractive in 2003. It's just, I mean, not that these ladies aren't attractive, of course, but it's like,
no, I get what you're saying. Cause like, I mean, look, let's sidebar and say, like, obviously Sable, Tori are attractive and obviously they're sexy and like all of that. But like, there was a lot of this that I kind of was like, why the hell did we like this?
I mean, Sable had like a bodybuilder figure.
Yeah.
Like, it was just very gaunt and nothing was moving, you know?
I guess more so what I'm saying even, it's just like Tori, for example, doesn't move like a stripper is probably the best way to say it. It's like, I'm like thinking to myself, I'm like, now I guess that I'm a grown man compared to like a teenager at this time.
Right.
I'm like, I'm almost like, man, they just made them go out there and just like act like strippers essentially. And then like, that's it. And I'm like, this is terrible. Yeah.
And it's not even like, oh, you had to be there because the crowd is silent pretty much until they like.
Right. And that's what I'm getting at is like the crowd didn't even care. And so like, again, I don't like obviously scantily clad women. Everybody was like, yay. But everybody still wanted like a good show. And this wasn't like anything.
Mm-hmm.
And I would argue, actually, to correct me if I'm wrong, if you felt like this, did Sable not win that contest? As in, like, the crowd reaction. I'm talking about like they tried to hide it, but I feel like she got a louder cheer than Tori.
I noticed that too. Well, there was a bit of shenanigans afoot. I think maybe it wasn't exactly a clean victory for Tori.
Right. That's what I'm getting at.
Because so they both come out. First of all, why is Tori getting a WrestleMania live performance for this?
Lillian Garcia performs her to the ring, and I actually meant to ask you in those same exact words. I was going to say, why didn't this happen at WrestleMania? Because like it's just a random Judgment Day pay-per-view, and right. That's the one. I guess. Hold on. Let me bring it back here. Interpromotional thing, because Raw Lillian Garcia. But then again, you could still do it at WrestleMania if it's interpromotional.
Exactly.
But that's how I felt too. I was like, that was a WrestleMania performance.
Lillian Garcia sings Tori's music, sings her to the ring. This entrance was 1 minute shorter. It was 1 minute shorter than the opening match. but you can sing it if you want. I don't know the words.
I just need a little space to call my own. Just a corner of the world I could be alone. Where do you run to? What do you do when everybody wants you? How do you breathe when they take your air?
There it is.
I'm glad that I just have that like on my hard drive now. You doing that?
I just need some satisfaction, some primal interaction. I know, I know these songs.
I don't know if that's something to brag about, bud.
No, I am single for a reason.
Because you just bust out in 2003 Divas theme songs?
Yeah, the only people who want me are Lillian Garcia or Tori Wilson, and I can't have them.
Not with that attitude.
Well, Tori, if you're available, just let me know. I'm no Derek Jeter. Well, who was it? Who did she date?
I mean, she was with Billy Kidman for a while, and you're at least Billy Kidman status, right?
Right.
Are they still together? I don't know.
No, they've long been... I've heard stories about Billy Kidman just acting a fool with women in Tampa. I'll just say it like that.
Oh, man. He's just throwing shooting star presses onto all the ladies, huh?
He's like, do you know who I am? I'm fucking Billy Kidman. I'm like, I don't think I'd brag about that.
Well, no Billy Kidman here, unfortunately. We just got Taz, who's hosting this little shindig, which I think is the
Why did they put Taz in this position? Oh, because poor Taz. I feel like they were just trying to rib him when they did stuff like this. I gotta ask, I literally want to tweet this man of like, why'd they always put you in bikini contests on SmackDown?
He was a great host, man. I mean, who else? You got to throw Josh Matthews out there?
Well, yes. But I just didn't need Taz calling everyone tomatoes.
I loved his like explanation of like, they're both ladies are out there, and he's like, all right, so what you gonna do is music gonna play or something. You gotta shake your booty or whatever, you know, go crazy. Or whatever, or however Taz talks.
That sounds like Art Donovan.
There's a very
who's gonna shake their ass first, huh?
That's what this needed. Was Art Donovan still around during this point? If so, they should have drug him out here. He
might have been dead. I don't know.
And either way, you know. So speaking of dead, like we said, the crowd is silent during all of this. It's very weird. I mean, you can basically see what Sable ate for dinner. It's just, I mean, to call it a bikini, I think it's a bit generous.
Okay, so I was like, you know, granted, I know how attractive Sable was, but I was like, this was a very big reminder that I was like, Sable's still pretty hot in like 2003.
Yeah.
I was like, now I see why Brock, she cheated on her husband with Brock, you know, it's just, or why Brock went after her, I should say.
You don't think Mark Mero was up to snuff with Sable's figure here?
Have you not heard that story about Mark Mero saying when he found out that Brock Lesnar was cheating, you know, Sable was cheating with Brock Lesnar? The gist of it is essentially he goes, when I found out that she was cheating with Brock, I said, well, good for them, because I'm not going after Brock Lesnar.
Yeah, I mean, it's, what are you going to do, man?
Fucking Brock Lesnar.
Gotta take the L on that one.
Yeah, you just, thank you, ma'am. It was a great marriage, and I'll call it a day.
Good luck to you, sir. Please don't hurt me. But then Tori does her thing. She has a bikini on that's like a relatively normal looking bikini. And with then
Playboy bunnies.
Yes, because I don't even know if I mentioned this. The whole reason for this kind of animosity is, you know, Tori's the new Playboy cover lady. And then Sable's the old one. And Sable's threatened by Tori, like, oh, you think you're better than me? And that's basically what this is.
Right. Which I feel like would have been a better storyline if they had mentioned that more as opposed to just posing. I don't know. You know what I'm getting at. They could have fleshed it out more as opposed to fleshing it out more.
I don't know. At the time, I guess that's all they needed was flesh. So,
not from those crowd reactions.
Well, I mean, Tori knew how to get them because, you know, they do their things. They, Taz, you know, what do you think about Sable? What do you think about Tori? And to your point, Sable, I think, did edge her out a bit. But Tori's like, wait a second, I'm not done. So apparently she has a double layer bikini. So she takes off the Playboy underoos to reveal dental floss or whatever the hell this was, basically what Sable was wearing. And she dances again, and Taz is like, we don't even need to hear the reactions. I think it's unanimous.
Right. Tori- he literally is just like, Tori's the winner. Tori's the winner. And it was funny, you know, I mean, look, hey, I'm a short guy too, but it's funny because Taz is like shorter than him. Right. He's like putting his hand above him. So it's just kind of funny.
Well, they're wearing heels, but, you know?
Yeah, but oh my God, it was just funny to see the whole like, we don't even need a crowd reaction. There, we're going with this. I'm sure they buzzed him in his ear of like, do not go to the crowd again for Tori because... They're like, Sable's getting, like, because Sable is no slouch in the looks department. She's literally the first, the first WWF diva in Playboy. So, you know what I mean? So, yeah, as you said earlier, though, I think Sable won this. I really do think Sable had won this already from the reactions.
Yeah. I mean, that was my thought watching this is like, I think this is the first, like, actually competitive bikini competition because they always have, like, some woman in mind to win that's always, like, blows. You have like Nydia or something. Not that Nydia is unattractive, but you know, she has like.
Right. But Tori's the it girl.
Yeah.
So it's like, you know, and yeah, she's doing the like redneck bubblegum thing. Yeah. So they, but yeah, this one was definitely like, you know, the old guard and the new guard.
Yeah. I mean, it was a back and forth matchup and 5 stars.
I was going to say, I like how we're like analyzing this. Like
I think we're going to spend more time on that than anything. Content.
They put no thought into this and we're like, you know, the old lion doesn't lay down for the young lion.
Changing of the guard. I didn't really have that thought, but you're right. Well, Eric Bischoff's drunk. He has pizza in his pocket. They're in the skybox again. Eric Bischoff can't hang, apparently. You know,
is this the wings? Is this where they get the wings?
No, this is Pickles.
I got something to say.
We're not at Wings, we're at Pickles.
Okay, I got something to say when we get to Wings.
Bischoff thinks they're pickles. So let me just set the scene, fellas. So Eric doesn't feel good. You know, he's about to puke. Awesome's like, hey, try some of these pickles. They'll make you feel better. But this pesky Steve, they're not pickles. They're jalapeno peppers. So Bischoff's like, oh, geez, these are spicy. Give me something to drink. And then Steve Austin hands him the jar of jalapeno juice and Bischoff drinks it and spits it all over the place. It's just pure comedy, you know?
Great. Three Stooges type comedy here.
It's good stuff. It's good shit now. But we're back to old Piper, Roddy, that is, against Mr. America.
Can we just like gloss over this one? Cause I was just like, why the hell are you watching Hope versus Piper in like 2003 at this point?
Hogan versus Piper on a B pay-per-view, in the middle of a B pay-per-view in 2003 is just a funny
context thing. Right, and this is why anybody that thinks it's like I'm just a WWE mark, I just call it how it is, right? WWF was making fun of the geezers in WCW and talking about making fun of like Hogan and Piper.
Yeah,
and then 5 years later they're doing the same match.
Well,
it's like, what?
I hate to correct you, Kenny.
Sorry. I know what you're going to say.
It's not Hogan and Piper.
Right.
Mr. America and Piper. So, completely different.
Oh, I thought you were going to say Hogan and Sean O'Hare's daddy.
Oh, I should have gone that route. See, that's why you're the pro. That's why you're the pro.
All right.
So, we got Vince McMahon backstory here. Hogan's kind of related to this. So, after the WrestleMania, of course, Vince versus Hogan at WrestleMania, Hogan beat the shit out of him. Vince is like, all right, Hogan, I'm not going to fire you, but I'm just going to let your contract run out. So you're going to die at home of leprosy, is what he said, which I don't even know if that's what leprosy is, but
no, not at all.
Just sounds good, I guess. But Hogan adopts a new character, Mr. America. And you might be asking, why would Vince sign a guy that looks just like Hulk Hogan? Well, it wasn't Vince. It was Stephanie McMahon, the GM of SmackDown, signed Mr. America sight unseen just because she heard about how big this guy was.
She heard the buzz. She heard the buzz about Mr. America, the 23.9-inch python.
Well, who didn't hear the buzz at the time, you know?
Right. But what's funny, I mean, you got to remember, at the time, Hogan's using Voodoo Child by Jimi Hendrix.
Right.
So what does Mr. America use? Real American.
Of course he does.
So familiar song. So I don't know if Hogan allowed that. But I guess this is one of those things where I'm just like, I know they're letting Hogan sit his contract out, but you're already repackaging his theme song.
Let some time pass, you know?
Right. Exactly. It's like we associate it with Hogan.
Right. But Hogan said he's a big fan of Mr. America. So maybe there's some.
It's true. And then it's there. I'm a real American, Mr. America. Like, I get it.
Yeah.
And plus,
yeah.
That song wasn't made for Hogan, technically. It was made for the American Express, Wyndham and Rotunda.
Oh, I thought I'm it was telling made for the you, Patriot.
No, that's Kurt Angle's song.
Right.
I actually, as much as I joke, I actually do know some stupid wrestling knowledge.
Well, it comes in handy, huh? For moments like this.
I think it's the U.S. Express, by the way. I just realized I said the American Express.
It's, it's like you don't even watch wrestling, you know?
No, I don't. I experience wrestling, sir.
American males, you know? So
American males. American males.
That's a good point. But you might be saying to yourself, well, this couldn't possibly get any more ridiculous. Well, on SmackDown, I think it was a week or two before this, Piper and Sean O'Hare ganged up on Mr. America, beat him down in the ring. Zach Gowen, or, you know, a random fan,
yeah,
who's waving this big ass American flag. Hogan calls him out in his promo beforehand. And
yeah,
as Mr. America is getting beat down, Zach Gowen hops the barricade, goes into the ring to try to save Mr. America. Piper tries to pull him off and pulls his leg off of his body. And fun stuff. And Piper's, you know, he's not like, ah, I got your leg. He's like, oh, God, it's like there's an element of realism, I guess, to it, which I can appreciate. But it's just a lot going on.
I think the joke is Piper went and started pulling on the real leg. And Gowen basically had to say, no, it's the other leg. He's trying to yank off his real leg.
That's my shoot leg, brother. Get my working leg. Got his third leg.
Right. That's not my leg, brother. But you can keep yanking.
If you keep yanking, it's going to pop eventually. But we got Mr. America coming out here. He has a chair for Zach. He introduces Zach Gowen. I think it's the first time we hear his name. And then Mr. America and Roddy Piper proceed to have a match, if you want to call it that. I mean, I guess it wasn't, like, all things considered, it was fine. It was relatively short. They did the classic stuff. They played the hits. At one point, though, Mr. America rolls up his mask to bite Piper. And it's like, okay, isn't that kind of revealing who you are? But
I mean, you also do have to remember that this was 03 TV standards. So, like, we weren't getting, like, the high quality stuff we're seeing on the cock now.
Right.
So the cock didn't exist back then.
No cock? Cockless?
What? Yeah, we were cockless back then.
Yeah.
So we were watching on pay-per-view and it was all fuzzy looking. You know what I mean? So, but also there was an ongoing joke where they would reveal Mr. America's face, and then, like, Michael Cole sitting there like, did we catch the face? It's not Hogan.
And yeah, I should also mention, so there was, you know, Vince was mad at Stephanie for signing this guy, and then Stephanie was like, hey, if you can prove that it's Hulk Hogan, you can fire him. But Stephanie apparently signed Mr. America to an ironclad contract where he can't be fired for any circumstance, like, which is like a weird move. Like, it's bad, I mean, business.
That's not a Hogan move to me.
Yeah, I guess. Should have been their first clue. But Sean O'Hare gets involved during the match, and ultimately Sean pipes Piper, hits Piper with a pipe, and then Hogan takes advantage, hits the leg, gets the win. And as he's pinning him, Zach Gowen holds back Vince McMahon, because Vince comes out during this match, and Vince tries to get in to break up the pin, but Zach Gowen holds him back. And so that's where we're at.
Honestly, best nap I ever had watching this back.
Oh, it's a good one. It's a dandy. You should go check it out.
Yeah.
man. Well, it doesn't get any you get the Stephanie versus Vince after this, and it's just boy howdy. Zach Gowen, what a run. What a run that
well,
kid had.
Well, let's remember that so Hogan in real life gets fired, as in like didn't there was a misunderstanding or something. There anyway, there was heat between him and Vince for real. And so he leaves WWE. And so they use footage from Madison Square Garden off the air.
Right. Where
because what he used to do after his match, Mr. America, was he would take off the mask and then he'd go shh like that.
Yeah.
And they showed it. And then so the Vince character goes, see, I knew it was Hogan. Damn it. I knew it. Hogan, you're fired. And so that's where they kayfabe fire him because he found out. And then so Zach Gowen has to go into this program by himself.
Yes.
So Zach Gowen, being the Mr. America fan, all of a sudden becomes the one-legged man in the asking contest, quite literally, and has to do like the storyline with Vince alone, which kudos to him, man. He did it. I mean, he did it in the summer of 03. Nobody was going to stand in his way. Give it up, son. He did it his way.
Dude, I forgot about his theme song. Holy shit. I'm sure that's stepped over on cock.
I heard a rumor, which I don't understand what how this would happen, but apparently his mother was the one that said, like, I think you should use this song. Why would his mom have heard like a Seether song that wasn't released at the time?
Is it Seether?
It is Seether.
Interesting.
Out of my way. Yeah. I'm telling you, I know wrestling songs for some reason. That's just my thing.
That was just a dormant memory that you unawoken or that you woke.
Nobody's gonna stand in my way.
They were in my way. Oh god, it's a bop. It's a bop.
It is.
Well, more on that, I guess, as time passes. But no one's gonna stand in Kevin Nash's way either. I mean, other than, you know,
under his quad.
His muscles, yeah, ripping apart from his body. But
right.
He's competing for the world heavyweight title here against the champion, Ric Flair. I just saw his name there. Against the champion, Triple H, with Ric Flair. And Kevin Nash is out here with Shawn Michaels in his corner. I didn't hate this match, honestly.
Okay, so let's talk about that. First of all, I wanted to hate this match because I was like, Shawn Michaels got a bigger pop than Kevin Nash.
Right.
Like, Nash barely got a reaction, which also, but to give credit to Kevin Nash, man, that pyro was awesome. I've always loved Kevin Nash's pyro.
Yeah, yeah.
The diesel pyro, you know. Go watch it back if you don't know what I'm talking about. It has no business being that good. Okay. So, why the hell were why were Ric Flair and Shawn Michaels even out there? Because they brawl for like 2 seconds and then they're gone.
Yeah, I mean, look, so, it was because they really built up, like, oh, Shawn Michaels is going to be in the corner of Kevin Nash. But like you said, it's like, right, I think it's even before the match starts. It's like during the entrances, Kevin Nash, you know, attacks Triple H in the aisleway, and then Flair and Shawn basically take each other out. So now it's one-on-one. So I guess in theory it was effective because he took Ric Flair out of the equation. He's always right. Obviously getting involved. Yeah,
right.
So.
I like when you explain things in kayfabe, right? Because that's true. It's true. And it's exactly what he should have done, which is like he let Kevin Nash have the one-on-one as opposed to just being Ric Flair interfering all the time. And this is like what? A month or two before... Or was Evolution already a thing at this point?
So it was, but then Orton and Batista both got injured.
Injured, right. And that's what I was going to say. So it quietly was like gone. So they almost like reintroduce Evolution within the next month.
So we're in like
here.
The limbo period at this point. Yeah.
Right. Right. So Evolution, at this point, Evolution is a mystery, right?
Yeah. I mean, they really drew the line in the sand there, I think. So.
Right. Full of change that no one sees.
Right. Exactly. I was going to say. Yeah. Poor Mark Jindrak. But... we got Nash, Triple H, and they have, it's, you know, nothing to write home about, I guess. But like I said, it was like they played to their strengths.
That's what I was going to say. I was going to say that, like, I got off a track, but I felt like this match was really cold at first. But by the end of the match, they had gotten the crowd into it enough that it was just like, okay, this is actually like half decent. I think that's why we're like having a... argument over like, was this good or was it bad? Because like it didn't have any business being good, but like by the end of it they were like the crowd was pretty into it. Triple H takes a gnarly bump because he went neck first through that table.
That was a brutal jack. I mean, he took a jackknife in the ring and
in the ring
table. Yes,
which by the way, the one in the ring, I forgot how beautiful a move, which I know is weird to say in terms of wrestling, but how beautiful a move the jackknife powerbomb is. Like, yeah. Nash doesn't get enough credit for how good that powerbomb is, because other people would just kind of like slam people down. Nash would take them up, and then right when they got to that point of momentum, he'd just kind of do this drop like this. But it looked so like...
Yeah, visually, it looks more
elegant. And I was going to say it looked elegant in a destructive way. I don't know how to explain it, but yeah, Nash doesn't get enough credit for that jackknife, and which was a clever name, by the way, jackknife.
Yeah.
Since he was Diesel.
I mean, it's one of those moves where it could either look really good or really bad. I mean, WrestleMania 11 did not look good against Shawn Michaels.
Shawn Michaels going feet first down. I remember that one.
Yeah. Or the Giant. Looked devastating, I guess.
That was a good one, though. That was
probably the best
one. I watched that one live, man.
But yeah, I mean, even 2003 Nash, who is far behind or ahead of his prime? His prime is behind him. But still looks really good. Yeah, past his prime. That's what I'm looking for. But you said this match is cold in the beginning, and I would agree. I mean, this feud in general was very cold because, yeah. I mean, there's probably a lot of factors. One being Goldberg is there. People are probably hungry for Goldberg taking the world title and like, why is Nash in the way of this? But also it was just like Nash comes back and he's like, wants Shawn and Triple H to be friends, but that they don't want to be friends. And then Triple H low blows Kevin Nash in a tag team match. So it was like, it's a whatever story. They have this long ass brawl on Raw. I don't know if you remember this. It's like two weeks before this. It was like basically a match. It was like 20 minutes of them just like fighting around the arena. They're both bloody. Triple H ends up like they like fight to the outside and Triple H hijacks a guy and drives his car away. So, which sounds fun, but it was really like, I don't want to say it was boring, but the crowd wasn't into it for sure.
But yeah, it was because like, it's like you said, that time period of Raw was just weird. And so like, this is what we're getting.
Yeah.
And it's like, yeah, the crowd did not respond to it.
And the brawl, it was a brawl structured like a match, if that makes any sense. Like, because brawls tend to be more like desperate and kind of scrappy, whereas this was just like punch, walk, 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 punch. And it was like that for all. So, but that's what the build of this was. So it wasn't very hot going into it. But to your point, I think they got the audience at some point during this match. But at some point, so Triple H exposes the turnbuckle, hits the pedigree. After Nash goes into the turnbuckle for a two count, which is a pretty fun false finish. But eventually Triple H just hits the ref with a sledgehammer, which I guess we could get DQ'd. Boos from the crowd, and then they fight to the announce table where Nash hits the jackknife through the table.
And neck first, with no TVs or anything taken off. So Triple H took the full brunt of that. And I don't know how he got up after that, because it looked bad.
Yeah. And I mean, obviously a DQ finish for a world title match on a pay-per-view is never something that you want to see. I mean, I feel like this would have been cool as the buildup. Like if this happened on Raw, maybe not the match, but at least like the aftermath.
Yeah, that's a good point. Yeah.
But I don't know. They go on to have a Hell in the Cell, which I forget how that goes. I think it's not that bad, if I remember correctly.
No, that was actually half decent. I think that was the one Mick Foley refereed.
Yes.
So it almost became like a three-way match in a way, which they were just like, footless and damn it. We can't do Triple H and Nash again. Foley, get in there.
We need something. We need a hat on this hat.
Yeah. But I honestly think this should have just been a tag team match, like Triple H and Ric Flair versus.
Well, they did.
I know they had done. I was going to say, I know they had done that, but it was just like this match. It could have been better. Could have been better.
Yeah. Well, we're at Wings now, Kenny. What are your thoughts on the Wings? Yeah.
I just found it hilarious that Austin was trying really hard. This girl walks in and she, you know, she's being a server. I mean, she's handing him wings and then he's kind of like putting his hand on her back. And at first I'm thinking like, does he like this girl? Like, is he trying? But what I'm realizing, you know, as he's doing it is like, he's trying to nonchalantly like flirt with her on air. But really what he's doing is trying to put her in her position, which was, she's supposed to be on the other side of him on the left in between her and Bischoff. So that the camera can catch it properly. And so he's, again, nonchalant. He's kind of like, come here, babe, kind of like flirting with her, but he's really pushing her there. Mm-hmm. And she's not going at first. And it was just kind of awkward. I was like laughing about it. Because I'm like, Austin's a pro, man. He was like, not going to say, like, get over there. But he's like literally pushing her. Like,
I just thought Austin was being handsy. I was like, whatever, you go on.
Right. Yeah, that's what I mean. That's what he tried to come across as, like, you're just being handsy. But in reality, he's like, you're ruining my work there, sister.
Because Bischoff's like, I've never had jalapenos. We don't have jalapenos in Minnesota. And Austin's like, oh yeah. And he grabs a lady and he's like, hey, let's go to Minnesota sometime. They got good hunting, good fishing. And then the camera like zooms in on Austin's face and then it zooms back out. And Bischoff proceeds to puke out of the window of the skybox onto the fans.
He's gonna puke.
Could have really used draws here. I think he would have. Because that was probably
done a better puke job.
Oh, it would have been shoot puke at least. So,
right. I mean, this girl got it on her shoulder.
She got it. She got the whole load on her shoulder.
She did. When they could show the slow mo, I realized that half of it hit her shoulder.
That's why she didn't want to be in that position.
That's really what it was. She was trying really hard to be like, I'm gonna fuck this up. I'm not gonna, I don't want that.
Well, speaking of women, we got the women's title on the line in a fatal four-way match. The champion Jazz defending against Jacqueline, Trish Stratus, and Victoria. You can tell by the entrances that this is gonna be quick.
Right, they rushed it. I was like pissed. I was almost like pissed that, like, man, it's such a different era, because it was like,
yeah,
Jerry Lawler sitting there calling them ugly. Like, he's sitting there going like, what did he say? Like, basically implied Victoria was ugly. I'm like, Victoria's gorgeous. What are we talking about?
Jazz looks like Mike Tyson.
Right, Jazz looks like Mike Tyson, all this. It's just like, it was a tough position to be in, because the crowd was already cold from the Triple H Nash match. So it's like, not only was it a quick match, but like, they weren't getting it love at first.
Right.
But they won them over. There were some hard hitting. There's one bump specifically I wanted to talk about. That was
to the Stratus faction.
Crazy. Yeah.
Yeah. What happened there?
So Victoria's about, or holding Trish. So Trish is about to run up the ropes to hit her with the Stratus faction. And Victoria basically tosses her over the ropes. Now, if you're not watching this, I just want to give you the visual. Now, if somebody gets tossed over the top rope, usually they'll grab a rope, they'll hit the apron, the hardest part of the ring, by the way.
Nice.
So they'll do something to kind of break their fall. When I say Trish launched over the top rope and just face plants completely on the floor, I was like, no wonder she got the respect she got in an era where they were not respecting the women's wrestling, let's be blunt. Because 2 years ago, she was eye candy doing the strip kind of stuff. And then 2 years later, she's like arguably the best worker in the friggin' women's division. And like, for her to do that bump, I think like, she didn't have to do stuff like that. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I was just blown away that, like, when I saw it, I was like, whoa, like, who does a bump like that?
Dude, I always praise, like, when these women's matches come up, like, the women worked their asses off in this time period. Like, they didn't get the time. Maybe they didn't get the TV focus, but it's a lot better than people probably remember, because they always remember the bikini contests and the bra and panties matches. But there are matches like this. I mean, just look at this lineup: Jazz, Jacqueline, Trish, Victoria, like four of the best workers of this era. And they had, with the time they had, I thought it was a pretty solid match. I thought the finishing stretch was fun.
I did too. Yeah. But let's also, I mean, look, I almost don't want to bring this up because it's not for that reason, but like, so when, you know, Jazz is hitting the bitch plants on everybody, which, yes, right, it was called the bitch plant, correct me if I'm wrong. So she's hitting the bitch plant, she hits one of Jackie, and for lack of a better term, Jackie's whole top kind of goes over, and she's about to have like a wardrobe malfunction. She's on the floor like this, but she's a pro, so she's laid out. And it was like, it's so stupid, but I look for nuances in professional wrestling. So when Jazz goes to cover her, she does it in such a way where she puts her hair forward and she kind of like buries her stuff in. And I was just like, she's letting Jackie fix her top. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, little stuff on my man. Like, she's the wherewithal to be like, you know, my opponent's tits about to pop out. Let me cover her properly. I'm like, right. I'm like, she is such a freaking pro. And I'm like, Jazz especially, I feel like, doesn't get enough love for this time period.
Oh, yeah.
Of like how good she was. And so I'm just using that as an example to just show those little things of like why the girls probably like loved Jazz.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, like, I don't understood.
I don't know why she didn't rise above kind of where, I mean, she didn't last long. But she was a beast, right, man. I mean, she stood out. She was a dominant looking champion and, you know, a good foil for someone like Trish to fight against. So I don't know, man.
Right, right. And I love that whole, like, you know, the actual wrestler versus the Barbie doll kind of like dynamic that they had. And it almost like made Trish have to work with her, like have to work her ass off with her. Mm-hmm. Underrated feud. Like you said, I think Jazz would be more respected in, like, you know, more of a current WWE mm-hmm. than back then.
Yeah, I mean, she had a semi-recent run in Impact.
Impact, right.
Yeah, so she's definitely respected in hindsight for sure, as are all these women, I'm sure. But, I mean, hell, Trish just had a great cage match with Becky Lynch just a few months ago, which is funny to think about. But
yeah, absolutely. I just realized, like, the sun went down, so, like, my lighting's all just, like...
Oh, it's very mysterious.
Yeah.
It fits with the Judgment Day theme. Maybe the light is just, by the way, Jazz wins. I don't know if we even mentioned that.
Right. When she went for the win on Jackie there.
Yes, yes. And the light is shining upon you for this stretcher match for the WWE Championship. Brock Lesnar, the champion, defending against the Big Show. Who doggy. First stretcher match in 17 years, Kenny.
It was, now mind you, I don't remember if they said it, but I just remember it wasn't Andre in like the Great Khan or
Killer Khan.
Killer Khan.
Yes.
Sorry.
Nick Khan, I think.
Nick Khan, the killer Nick Khan.
Yes. Yes.
Oh, I'm going to sign you for seven figures, brother.
What? So why is, so the stretcher is out there all night, by the way. It's like a right. prop used. Like, I don't know why you can just roll it out for the match. I don't.
Because, well, like you said, they used the Judgment Day, or sorry, the Armageddon set for Judgment Day. So they're like, how the hell are we going to make it different? Art, and he's like, why don't you put a stretcher out there for everybody to see? And they're like, Art Donovan, that's genius. Yeah.
Genius. You can always rely. I mean, his name's Art for a reason, you know?
Right. He created it.
He did, unfortunately. So we are on the heels. We brought it up earlier, the Backlash. Big Show, Rey Mysterio match, where Big Show swung Rey like a baseball bat on a stretcher, took him out, and then Lesnar came out on SmackDown the week after. He's like, hey, Big Show, pick on somebody your own size. And Big Show's like, only if you put that title on the line, and that's why we're at. And then Brock's like, if you like stretchers so much, let's have a stretcher match. And I kind of enjoyed the match. I thought it was fun. I think the aesthetic of like the backboard, just the way it sounds when you get hit with it, I loved it. It was just so funny.
Yeah, and it probably does not hurt as much as it's just like, it just whips around. So I think this is one of those matches where I went like, this is why they gave Brock the world right away. Because like, there was no business for Brock to be in his career working a match this well. Like, this was akin to like his SummerSlam 2021 match, where it was kind of like fun shenanigans, especially towards the end. Mm-hmm. But I was like, this is literally what, a year into Brock's main roster run. So
yeah,
like I was like, okay, I get, like, not to say I never got it, but I was just like, yeah, these are those things where it's like, he was proving ground and he showed why he belonged, you know?
Yeah. I mean, yeah, he's only a year into his run and he already feels like a solidified top guy, which is just a testament to his ability for sure. Even as a babyface now, I mean, he's the top babyface on the roster. Your Kurt's gone, so Big Show's or Brock's got to make something out of it. But do you think 2003 is the best year of Big Show's career?
Well, I was going to say, I was actually like shocked, like watching this. I'm like, this is a Big Show match. And it's not to say Big Show was a bad worker, but it was like, it was more so like, yeah, he was doing some stuff that was from his. I didn't like the Big Show at this time, but like looking back on it, I'm like, man, he was very underrated at this time with his work with Brock and you know, Eddie later on, and
Kurt.
Yeah, so I would say maybe besides his like rookie year, like, this was probably his, you know, this was his best year in WWE,
right? Yeah, because he spent so much of his career just kind of like in the background, unfortunately. But it felt like he was a legit threat to the world title at this point, which is not something you can say about a lot of his career, unfortunately. And
he was the first one to beat Brock, you know, at Survivor Series 02.
Yeah.
So, I mean, you know, that's when he won the world title. So, I mean, they believed in him at the time.
I think at this point, he's the only one to have beaten Brock. I don't think anybody else has beat him at this point.
Right.
But yeah, naturally, a lot of this match happens on the outside because they have to put the guy on the stretcher and push them past the yellow line that's up by the ramp. It's the whole thing's like, how are you going to fit Big Show on this stretcher? Which they like kind of do, but he keeps falling off. And then Brock at some point just, he does a Cody Rhodes walk to the back. He's like, I got something for you.
He was such a good baby face. Like, I think about that. Like, we don't see that Brock.
Yeah.
Like, as like, this was like genuine baby face Brock. And I was just looking at like that movement of like the, you know, the like, look, and I'm going to hit the ropes and like right. hit the Big Show kind of thing. And I'm like, I forgot that Brock had evolved into like the genuine baby face, like mm-hmm. that is in peril, you know, like it was crazy to watch because I'd forgot about it. You know?
I mean, Big Show is probably the only one that can put him there, but
right, fair enough.
It worked here for sure. But Brock heads to the back to get something. But in the meantime, old Ray Ray's back. Rey Mysterio pops out to get his revenge on the Big Show, hits him with a 619 to the dick, and maybe another one. I forget, but at some point, Big Show grabs Rey by the throat, is going to choke slam him again, but Brock Lesnar comes, he skids out with this forklift. I don't know if he's had a forklift job in his past. This man knew how to drive a fucking forklift because he bashes through the sets.
Right.
Like Tokyo drifts his way out there. And
that's a farm boy for you, man, because like the same thing at SummerSlam 2021. It was like that's why I think I was thinking of it. Because it's like that boy could drive, you know, a tractor. The boy could drive a forklift here, like maneuvered it like a champ.
Dude, I think maybe that's why the set is what it is, because he could drive through all those pipes and make like the cling-a-ling sound.
No, that's what it was. They were like, we need to destroy a set. They're like, just put the fucking Armageddon one out there. We're not going to use it again.
Yeah. Yeah. But skids out there, forklift, gets on top of the forklift, jumps from the top of the forklift into the ring.
Did you see the height or the length of that? Like,
that's crazy.
When they cut to the wide shot, I realized how far that jump was, because they didn't really catch the jump. They caught it like mid-jump. And I was just like, he jumped from there all the way to there? Brock's a beast, man.
Off the top of a forklift isn't exactly a natural thing to jump off of. It doesn't, no running right. start. I mean, he's a monster.
Yeah.
Then gives Big Show a vertical suplex and then an F5, which is never not impressive watching that.
I love his F5s to the Big Show because they end up being like FUs essentially, or, you know, attitude adjustments for the younger crowd.
Yeah.
But I mean that in the best way possible. Like, he hits them reckless because he's throwing them like this. With Big Show, he's just like, get the fuck.
Just whatever it takes to get this man off of me.
It takes to get you.
So he hits him with the F5, lugs him onto this forklift, puts the stretcher on the pallet, puts Show on the pallet, and then puts him up to the sky, raises the pallet as high as he can, and backs up past the yellow line. And Brock Lesnar gets the win, retaining the title. And just the shot of him like on top of the forklift with the title. I mean, it was as good as this match as could have been, I think.
Yeah. And I mean, they ended the pay-per-view hot. Brock won that crowd back over, you know. So I think this, again, like you were saying earlier, I think it's a testament to how good SmackDown was at the time. Mm-hmm. Because that was a fire, you know, fire main event.
I mean, yeah, looking at the card, I mean, the highlights, the stretcher match, the ladder match. I mean, it's all SmackDown are the high points of this. Even like the bikini contest and the Mr. America shit. It's like silly, but it's like, I don't know.
Right.
Engaging. And
arguably, Raw had the bigger stars, too. And that's what's funny about this is like SmackDown just feels energetic and youthful, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, if you had to give this show a grade out of 10. What do you think you would throw at Judgment Day?
I'm a little bit too generous sometimes. I might say like a 6.
Yeah, I think at least a 6. I mean, it was definitely better than Backlash, which I had, you know, somewhat recently watched. So do with that what you will. But I mean, it had its high points. I thought it was paced well, where it was like, you know, here's a good thing, and then maybe a thing that's not so good, but here's another good thing. So it was, I didn't hate this show, honestly.
Right, and that's what I was saying. It's like, I think I went in with like really low expectations because, truth be told, I had this on DVD. I remember I bought it back in the day, and I remember thinking it was like one of the worst purchases I made. You know what I mean? Why did I buy Judgment Day? But like looking back at it, I was just like, okay, yeah, it was a fun little pay-per-view with the Intercontinental title stuff, the stretcher mat, you know, Tajiri looking all hot and sexy, and, you know, things like that. All
right. Well, speaking of hot and sexy, where can everybody find you and listen to you and read your stupid tweets?
That's where you can find me. I think right now I'm primarily on X or Twitter or whatever the hell Elon wants to call it this week.
Yeah.
At underscore Kenny Thoughts. I mean, I'll say it on the podcast. I think people can tell when I'm being like serious and being all like, you know, heartfelt. And then when I'm just being absolutely ridiculous, I think that's where my Twitter is kind of taken off, because it's like, I almost like put on the character and the bravado and the stuff that I wouldn't have said before. I'm kind of like brave enough to say it now. And so it's cool to get like people in my DMs of like, dude, you're a funny guy. Like, just keep it up, you know? And I was like, I would keep it up, but that's what she told me. You know, but I am getting older and it's harder to keep that up, you know? What were we talking about again?
Once again, thank you to Kenny from the Racist Chops podcast for joining me on this episode. Always a good time with Kenneth. Go follow the boy on all the social medias at underscore Kenny Thoughts on X, everything else. We'll be in the description. You know him, you love him. Maybe you at least know him. Follow me at Apron Bump on all the social medias. Like, subscribe, bump, bell, fiddle my asshole. Do all those things. Yeah. I think that about does it, huh? I think we can. No. No. Stop. So thank you guys. Stop. Stop it. We're done. We're going home. Thank you guys so much for listening. Love you all.
Yeah.
I'm hard.
And the hardest. Talk around and disregard it. Trip you off the ground, show you what heart is. Standing strong and proud of me, and I guess. Let's get started. It's the hardest. Talk around, don't disregard it. Sweep you off the ground, show you what heart is. Standing strong and proud, nothing can hide this.